أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم So we stated that the Prophet came and he awoke the people and he made them God-centric and he realized that there's a gradual process of growth. Now when we analyze this, we see that that is totally in sync with the way in which the human community has evolved. And this is the way in which the Quran has addressed the human community and the way in which the Quran talks about Islam in a very broader, in a very different way to the one that we have understood. And if we look at it accurately, we will see, as we stated yesterday, that the Islamic law system is minimalistic in order to allow for the beautiful growth process. However, when we look at the teachings of the Prophet, the Quran, and the stories of the Quran, we find that the Prophet of Islam did exactly what every other Prophet has done. And he has not done anything different, but brought about greater sophistication at the level of ahkam, and that was about it, due to the greater sophistication within the human community. So let's recap on that slightly. We have been saying that God was the factor of liberation. It allowed people to embark on their existential journey, which was naturally with them, of evolution and of growth. That needed to be directed in the time of the Prophet, as was the case prior to the time of the Prophet. In accordance with that, if we were to analyze the teachings of the Prophet, they fall into three categories: theology, morality, and the regulative system. Theology is all about God-centricity. That people, you have a purpose in life. You will see this life as an opportunity. Inwardly, there is a yearning, and that yearning is towards self-realization and completion from within your own selves. Outwardly, you want to break every barrier. Your minds will not rest. Your God has created you in this way. So the theology is a liberating theology. On the one hand, it gives liberation within the soul by becoming God-like. Surrender to God and begin to imitate God as God is. Become the finest human beings. Arrive at your God. Intellectually, the world is yours. Explore it. Achieve whatever you want to achieve from it. Explore the vast universe. There is no restraint upon you. This theology is a liberating theology. Then he said, but in order for you to become God-centric, you have to adorn your own souls with such wonderful morals. Become truthful, charitable, confident, givers of life, so on and so forth. And this, at the final level, is a law system that will cater for that in your limited context. Now let's explain this further. From the time of Adam till the time of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been talking about all these prophets being Muslims. In the case of Ibrahim, he says, "Huwa alladhi sammakumul muslimin." He is the one who officially gave you the designation of being Muslims. In the case of Dawood, he says, "I am a Muslim." He asks his children to not to die save in the state of Islam. In the case of the people of Isa, the Hawariyun, they say, "We are Muslims." In the case of Nuh and others, he says that they were all Muslims. Now, when we find the word Islam within the Quran, and when it is being praised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is Islam in a greater sense. If we see the verse, Inna deen indallah al-Islam, indeed the way of life with Allah is Islam, look at the early exegetical literature. And even the renowned exegesis of the present day, they will all say Islam here does not mean the organized faith that the Muslims are following. Islam here means that surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what we said was the vertical axis. The vertical axis is constituted by God-centricity, by theology, a theology that makes us God-centric, makes us gently tend towards Allah and liberates us intellectually and spiritually. Islam, whenever it's used within the Quran in a praiseworthy manner, it's used in the notion of greater Islam, not the lesser Islam that we have as a religion, which is compared to Judaism, Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism. That is not the Islam Quran talks about by and large. It talks about the broader Islam, in which Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, whatever else we have, constitutes a part of Islam, an ongoing process of Islam, an ongoing process of self-liberation of individual and community and communities interacting with each other. This Islam is a salient feature. It has always been the same. Mine, and he who comes with other than Islam as a deen, falay yuqbala min. He who comes with other than Islam as a way of life, it will not be accepted from him. It's not talking about this Islam that me and you are practicing, because as we will discuss in a day or two, that is something that is already rejected by the Quran, because the Quran says, "Inna ladina amanu wa ladina hadu wa nasara." Indeed, those who are Muslims, the Christians and the Jews, they are all on the same pedestal. Whoever brings faith in them will go into paradise. So it is not talking about this Islam, it is talking about something else. Now you tell me, if I were to say to you that I am a good human being, I am God-centric, and you tell me this verse, that according to this verse, it's not accepted of you, I will say, but what is the criterion of acceptance and rejection? What is the criterion? Let me give an example. You tell a student, you are doing this undergraduate degree. This is the material you're supposed to read, yes? The student does not read that material, reads some other material and still passes the exam. Will you say that he hasn't passed the exam? What is the yardstick of success? The yardstick of success is the actualization of the mind of that student and his ability to pass the exam. The yardstick is not which book he reads. So when Allah says it will not be accepted from him, the naive Muslims think that if you don't pray Salah with the ruku and sujood, you will not become a better person. But he has already become a better person. Mother Teresa is a pride for us, the human community. We pride ourselves over Mother Teresa, that she is one who represents our humanity and human instincts to the finest level. We take pride in her. Are you telling me that Mother Teresa, who did not do Hajj and Tawaf, her ibadat wasn't accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If it wasn't accepted, then she should have been somebody like Saddam. But she is a saint. Are you telling me that Pope who sits in Rome is not a father figure to us? Of course he's a father figure to us. His Islam has made him transcend Christianity. His Islam has liberated him. His is the true Islam, the one that he is in. So when these verses pop up, these are the verses that are talking about God's centricity. These are on the vertical. On the vertical axis are two things. That beautiful theology that talks about God's centricity, us becoming God-like. Our purpose is to complete ourselves spiritually and intellectually. And how we attain that purpose by becoming moral individuals. That is the vertical axis. That has never changed. The only thing that changes is the horizontal axis, the ahkam, the regulatory system, and nothing else. Let us explain this a little bit further in terms of form and essence. The vertical axis is essence. The rest of it is form. The vertical axis never changes. The form always changes. As the need changes, the way in which we package the vertical axis also changes. It is like a student studying from kindergartens to graduation. The vertical axis is to actualize the mind of the student. The horizontal axis is different textbooks, different methods of teaching. And that can't be otherwise. It will have to change. Now the reason why the Quran is ambiguous is only this, that the human community was supposed to grow beyond the Prophet. And you can't give them a formalistic system on the horizontal axis that can't change. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it ambiguous that it can evolve and change all the time through understanding of minimalistic Islam. It's minimalistic and it's ambiguous. And it's supposed to accommodate the vertical axis of growth and self-liberation as and how is needed through the growth process. If we look at the story of the prophets, Adam came in a very basic unit of a family. All he had was God-centricity and good morality. He did not have the horizontal axis as detailed as we have today. The horizontal axis of the ahkam of Islam and whatever, Adam had very few. He only had a few ahkam of what to eat and what not to eat, for example. But when we come to Ibrahim Nabi Nuh, it is far more sophisticated, for he has a whole community that is interacting. In order now to regulate that community in accordance with the vertical axis, there was a requirement for greater formulation. So the horizontal axis, which we call is the form, was far more detailed. When Ibrahim came, Ibrahim did not say that I abrogate whatever Nuh said to you about becoming godlike. Ibrahim said, no, it's the same message of Islam. Surrender to Allah gently, yearning Him lovingly, and evolve and break forth, explore your abilities and possibilities. That sense, that vertical axis was intact, the essence. The only thing Ibrahim changed was the horizontal axis, the form. When Musa came, he did not change the vertical, he changed the horizontal. The vertical was the same, become God-centric, become good moral human beings. The horizontal will allow you to become moral human beings. When Isa came, he did the same thing. When Muhammad Rasulullah came, he did not change any component of the vertical axis. Isa said killing is haram. Musa said killing is haram. Ibrahim said killing is haram. Adam said killing is haram. To the extent that when Kabil killed Habil, Allah recites the verse, he who kills one soul unjustly, it is as if he has killed mankind as a whole. And the same verse is given to Muhammad Rasulullah in the vertical axis. Giving life is a moral that you should have, a social moral, a social morality. You can't kill. Feed the poor. Be kind. Become godly from within. Question things. Liberate your minds. Explore the land. Travel. Seek whatever you can. This is on the vertical. The only thing that was changing was the horizontal. In this way, when we see that the human community has been evolving just like a baby evolves, the human community is no different. And that is why we are seeing that the human community, upon analysis, is in its teenages right now. It is in a state of rage. Give it a few more years. This human community will come to such a fine pedestal of moral existence that God will take pride in this human community. We are in our teens right now. Can you not see how wonderfully we have evolved? Previously, the popes of the churches took the Christians on crusades, butchering Muslims in the name of God. Today, if the church were to tell people to go and kill anybody, they will kill the church itself. Human mind and morality has matured to this level. Yesterday's Muslim was asking, can we donate to a non-Muslim who is dying? Today's Muslim will never ask such a question. They will know that human crises are our crises. We don't need any scriptures to tell us. Allah speaks from within us. Aren't you seeing how we are maturing? We are maturing. The central vertical axis is the same thing. We are always evolving, maturing. what changes is the horizontal. Now, give an example from the Quran about this beautiful maturing process of the human beings. If you read some of the surahs like Surah Araf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Aad and Thamud. He talks about Nuh, Aad, Thamud. He talks about Shu'aib. He talks about Musa and onwards and Isa. Now analyze these stories of the Prophet. It's amazing how little the Muslims read the Quran. I'm not talking about reading the Quran. I'm talking about reading the Quran. Yes? The Muslims don't read the Quran. You see, the first thing the Muslim will say is this Quran is a miracle. The first assumption is this Quran is a miracle. And this Quran is from God. And this Quran cannot be understood. So the first thing the Muslim does is shuts his mind up before reading the Quran. How will they ever be guided from the Quran? If they shut their minds to the Quran, how will they understand it? The Prophet of Islam said, whatever you find from me that is in conflict with the Quran, throw it away. What does that mean? That means the Quran is an ever-living book. It is there to guide us at every point, not for us to abandon it. What did the Prophet say at Ghadir Khum? I leave with you two weighty things, the book of Allah and my itra, progeny. But the book of Allah is heavier than my family. Everybody says this is authentic, that the book of Allah is heavier. So when the family statements are in conflict with the book of God, reject them. That means that the book of God is alive. Read it. What does Ali ibn Abi Talib say to his Sahabi? Read the Quran before you go into the marketplace and learn the law of transaction. The basic principles of transaction, of halal and haram, of not to cheat people, not to exploit people. That's the basic principle. If we read the Quran, and it's surprising how little we read the Quran, it's amazing. If we were to open up to the Quran, it will be another story altogether. However, obviously I don't want to point fingers at anybody, but I always make this point, and being a Maulana, I can't let it go. So you've heard this from me before, hear it again. If this Quran is a miracle, what has it done for me and you? Has it brought back the dead for us? Has it cured the sick for us? We read Yasin, people die. Can't you see the humor in that? We read the Yasin for the people, to kill people, don't we? We say he's not dying, read Yasin, kill him. Is that a miracle? That's barbaric. It's inhumane. Look at the way we are reading the Quran. You put the Quran on somebody's head, does it fill their heads with knowledge? In month of Ramadan, when we do the Amal, Beka Ya Allah, and put the Quran there, does it go from there inside here? In fact, we just feel the weight of the Quran, and we are just saying, when will it finish? When a Mulana comes and does excessive masayib together with the Amal, our necks strain, don't they? And then one of my friends says, thank God we've only got 12 Imams and no more. Imagine if we had 49 or 50 with those big Qurans on our heads. How little we read the Quran and how little we contemplate it. If we read it, we find gems of truth. If we look at Aad and Thamud, if we look at Nabi Nuh's people, I don't want to go into the intricacies of the story because it will take us away from our subject. We want to stick with our subject. Nabi Nuh was not sent by God in a programmed fashion, but if you read the Quran, it seems Nabi Nuh was an intervention of God. He was actually an intervention. There was a great flood coming because the ice caps had fallen somewhere. It would take years before it would come to his community. So Nabi Nuh on the spur was awoken. You are a messenger, take them out of this rut. If they believe, then this nature, beautiful nature that interacts with them, will save them. Nabi Nuh was an intervention. However, what happens? The whole of the community of Nabi Nuh is destroyed. You know that, right? Aad, Hud and Saleh, they came to their communities. There was not an intervention, they were sent. Yes, when we read the Quran, if we read it very analytically, yes, pay attention to every detailed reading. What happened? They took a few of their people out, the rest of them were destroyed. Hud and Saleh, Nabi Lut, their people, his people were going to be destroyed anyway. So the angels come and take Lut out. But when you come to and Nabi Shu'aib, the people are destroyed. But if you look at all these stories, you will find that the number of people who are being saved in this punishment are greater. You don't find the devastation of Nabi Nuh in Aad and Samud. You find a lesser devastation. In the time of Nabi Shu'aib, there is even a lesser devastation. A lot of the people are being saved. In the time of Musa, the Firaun and his army are destroyed. But their wives and children are alive. It's much lesser, the devastation is much lesser. In the time of Isa, there is no adhab. In the time of Muhammad Rasulullah, there is no adhab. It's the same thing, but what's happening is that the human community is maturing. At every level, the human community is maturing. And hence, there are greater number of people who are earning salvation, who are being spared, who are given different new chance to arrive at a different pedestal of existence, to work on themselves. So we have been seeing this evolutionary trend through and through. If we can understand this, then we come to our understanding of Islam. We can understand the prophetic understanding very accurately. You see, when the Shias lament that Imam Ali wasn't the first Imam, I always tell them, okay, he was the first Imam for the Sunnis and the Shias. Now what? What difference will it make to your Islam at present? Do you know what? They can't answer me. It's like saying, okay, God is not called Jehovah, he's called Allah. I'd say, fine, we'll call him Allah from now on. Now what? Have you become better people? Has it become better religion? So what? Okay, he is the first Imam. Sunnis, Shias, Wahhabis, Brailwis, Diobandis, everybody has accepted he is the first Imam. Fine, done. He is the first Khalifa, he is the first Imam. Finish, done. You're happy? Fine. So now what? You will find that there is no answer. There is no answer. Because the problem is somewhere else. And we've been caught up in such secondary issues. I'm not saying for those who are very sensitive. Yes? I'm saying, you look at the book of fiqh. The second Khalifa would always say, if Abu Hassan is saying this, follow what Abu Hassan is saying. Do you know this? Whenever Imam Ali would say, it's not like this, the second Khalifa would always say, if Abu Hassan, Imam Ali, if he's saying this, then follow whatever he is saying. He had utmost respect for him. Whatever else historically happened or not, you will not find that any of the Khalifas have disrespected Ali ibn Abi Talib when it's come to his judgment and his prestigious position. The third Khalifa, when his house was being, when he was under siege, he sent message to Ali salamu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, لَوْ كُنْتُ مَعْكُولًا فَكُنْ أَنْتَ آكِلِي. If I am somebody worthy of being consumed, then you consume me. In other words, if I am to be killed, if it is right to kill me, then you kill me. Imam Ali ran and saved him. This is the level, if you read books, you will find a very different story. Yes? So I will just say, the problem with Islam is that we haven't understood the prophetic understanding and we haven't understood the meaning of this great Imam Ali salamullah alayhi. We haven't understood. That's the problem. It doesn't matter to him whether you call him Imam or Khalifa. What is important is what we understand what he was trying to do, which we haven't understood. That is what we haven't understood. There's the problem there. So now, the Prophet introduces his Islam very subtly, very gradually. He looks at the Arabian community as little babies. He nurtures them. He gives them growth. He asks them to question. He gives them a purpose in their minds. You're supposed to become God-like. You have a hereafter to which you are evolving. You're supposed to be befitting moral human beings. It does not befit you to steal. It does not befit you to be greedy. It does not befit you to be a murderer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will feed you. You don't need to steal. Allah will give you your share. You don't need to lie. Allah will protect you. You don't need to be afraid. Allah is with you. Sleep a peaceful night's sleep. He liberates them slowly, gradually. Can you not see that when people with their hearts and minds are convinced about their God, they become different people altogether? They are not greedy, they are not insecure, they are not murderers, they are not cheaters. They are good human beings who do good. Whenever they get something, they thank Allah. They give it out and they thank Allah. Have you not seen godly people? They will go to China to learn knowledge. Have you not seen Abu Dharr? The Prophet said, there is not a leaf that falls from the sky, from a tree, branch of a tree, but that Abu Dharr has asked me about it. He is that inquisitive. Righteous people are people who are intellectually most progressed. Within their heart, they are most liberal. Within their soul, they're most humble. These are the people he made. And then he said, look, I am giving you this minimalistic system. In this minimalistic system, you have got the ingredients to evolve and to grow. And within his own time, and I'm going to, inshallah, discuss this further at length in the coming lectures, within his own lifetime, he said these Christians and Jews will coexist harmoniously with you. And his Islam was so broad and so minimalistic that allowed this sort of a noble status for the Jews and the Christians within his Islam. And then, when it came to the Majus, he said, they are the people of the book, treat them like the Jews and the Christians. Imagine how broad this man was. He comes to Medina, and he says to the people of Medina, we believe in whatever has been revealed unto us, and we believe in whatever has been revealed unto you. Your God and our God is one God. Why? Because the vertical axis was one and the same. The essence was one and the same. The only difference was at that formalistic horizontal axis. But even there, he left it so broad, so minimalistic, that the people could accommodate and broker a greater human unity in accordance with the human condition and need of humanity. The Prophet of Islam understood very well that this world is a world of individuality. There are no two things that are the same in this world. No two blades of grass will be the same. He knows no two people are the same. You need to have a broad minimalistic basis that accommodates this plurality. It is a human condition and human need to be pluralistic and to coexist harmoniously and to benefit and to grow through each other. He made it possible through his very dynamic Islam. It's beautiful, his Islam. Muhammad Rasulullah in 23 years did what no other prophet has done. Do you know this? I was at Hajj. You know how Khoja's Hajjis are? If you can find a rule that is easy, they will say it's not from God until you bring a hard rule. And I'm a lazy person. I'll go for the easiest option. So I took off those, you know, that minimalistic chumple that they wear, which kills the feet. And I wore my straps and my sandals. It took them 7 years to understand that. 7 years. They cursed me in Mina, and I know the people who have done this will be listening to me and laughing right now. We're all friends. But they cursed me in the walk from Mina, from Muzdalifah to Mina. At least I was smiling because my feet weren't hurting. They cursed me. Then they went to the Ayatollah, and Ayatollah said, actually, it's right, you can wear sandals. It takes 7 years to impress upon the mind of a follower that you can wear sandals as opposed to chappal. 7 years. He brought about the shift of paradigm in 23 years. Can you imagine what he's done? It was only possible because he introduced a minimalistic Islam at the horizontal level of horizontal axis, the formal Islam, which was so broad, so minimalistic, that allowed for this beautiful growth, that allowed for this cohesion between the society. Now, I'm going to discuss this in the lectures to come thoroughly, but I'm going to give a few hints. The vertical axis has never changed from Adam till now. That is known as the essence. If you look at the Quran talks about two things, or maximum three things required for salvation. What are these? The Quran does not talk about belief in any prophet. You know this? To become successful. The Quran says, believe in Allah, in the hereafter, and do righteous deeds, and you will have your success. We are going to talk about this thoroughly. Show me where Quran introduces a fourth component. Show me. Bring me a verse and I'll bring you 10 other verses that will interpret this verse for you. Show me where Islam is used as this formalistic, organized faith as a commendable religion to have. You will find Quran is talking about Islam on the vertical axis only. Be God-centric. Be accountable for whatever you're doing. So that's a moral deterrent. And become a moral human being and you'll have your success. This is the minimalistic requirement. And this is what the Prophet understood in his community. The only thing that fluctuates all the time are the horizontal axes. The ahkam, the laws, and this and that. They were always supposed to fluctuate in accordance with the maturing community that requires different standards at all times. Now you might say that the salah has been the same. I will agree with you. Maybe there are some facets of the vertical that acquire a form that is a stable form, like salah. Allah says that the Christians were commanded to pray, the Jews were commanded to pray, Ibrahim prayed. And because the Jews don't have ruku in their salah, Allah often tells them, do ruku, yes? So you can say yes, one or two extension of prayers, of devotion, might be stable, but the rest of it is all fluctuating. Are you actually telling me that success is in saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah and not understanding anything? Really? Honestly? Shaitan said La ilaha illallah and he's still saying it today. Do you know this? Iblis believes in Qiyamah. Do you know this? Is he successful? It also requires giving ourselves away to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think we need to point this out before my time finishes quickly today. That success is measured by the individual, not by anything else. If we read the verses of eschatology, Qiyamah, Allah will say on the day of Qiyamah, read your own book, today you are sufficient as a witness against you. I don't need to do anything to you. You yourself have judged yourself. Allah says in the Quran, this paradise is what you have earned. This hell is what you have sent forward. I have not done any of these things. You yourself have earned this. You have got it inside yourself. Allah says, every human will have a scroll written and tied upon his neck. Allah says, people will cry, what be with this book? There is not a big deed or a small deed, but that it is enumerated within this book. Allah says, on that day your hands and feet will speak. Allah says, your skin will speak. What does that mean? It means that you are a standard of success and you are a standard of failure yourself. So when somebody says salvation is through Islam, I will say, yes, but which Islam? It is like saying to a student, the student says, I gave this example a few nights ago. The student says, what is my success through this university education? The answer is, you yourself. What is my failure? You yourself. That paper only reflects what you are inside. That paper can be torn apart. So long as you have gained that ability for which you have studied, you are a success. And if you haven't gained that ability for which you have studied, you have wasted 4 years and a lot of money and a lot of time. You are the failure, you are the success. So when we talk about success on the vertical axis, in terms of the essence, the human being, him and herself are the standard of success and failure. So now, Allah says this success is assured by three things. God-centricity, being extremely mindful of everything we do, that's the Qiyamah component, and doing righteous deeds to increase our human godliness. And once you become godly, you are successful. Farmer is known as Fallah. The word for success in the Quran is Falaha. Fallah means when these seeds burst open, or when somebody cracks open the earth. Fallah, Falaha. It broke open and evolved from it. When that humanity evolves from us, when our intellectual shackles are broken, we are in the state of falaha. We are falah. Now, the Prophet gives a minimalistic horizontal axis, law system, system of regulation, in order to accommodate the vertical. This vertical is something that is always requiring different formulation as and how the human community is growing. This horizontal was never meant to be stable, was always meant to be in flux. I am not saying about the consumables. The pig and wine is haram. I'm not talking about the devotion. Namaz and Hajj is wajib and roza. But have we understood the meaning of roza and Hajj, understood the meaning of Hajj and understood the meaning of prayers? Can a fast be 22 hours? Can it be 2 hours? This is something we need to understand. But what I'm talking about is, apart from devotions, everything else will change and can change in order to accommodate the growth of the human community. And it has to change. Otherwise, the vertical axis will suffer. If we have restrictive laws within the regulatory system that do not allow us to reach out to somebody who is in a different organized faith, then here the human community as a whole is suffering. And the regulative system has to allow for us to embrace the other in a greater good, which we will be explaining later on. If the horizontal is restrictive, it becomes ungodly because it becomes inconsistent with the vertical. Isa came and he said to the Israelites, I have come to make halal a lot of the things you've made haram. You have made it haram. Allah has not made it haram. I have come to make it halal for you. I have come to clarify things for you. I have come to teach you how those values that Musa taught you will acquire expressions in your community. Read the Quran. This is what Muhammad Rasulullah says. It's the same truth. I have come to teach you how to formulate it afresh. I ask a question of the Muslim community in the few minutes that remain. You are saying to me that from Adam till Khatam, Allah has sent 124,000 prophets. Is that what you're saying? And these prophets have Ulul Azam inside them. Is that what you agree? And these Ulul Azam, Wasahibu Sharia, they brought their Sharia. Is that what you're saying? And you're also saying none of the Sharias were lies, they were all truths. Yes? But Musa's Sharia was better than Ibrahim and Isa was better than Musa. Does that mean that Isa should have come before Musa? Or does it mean that Musa's Sharia was right in his time and the best Sharia? And Isa's Sharia was right in his time and the best Sharia? Is that what you're telling me? So why did Isa replace Musa? Because the human community had evolved and grown. Are you telling me that after Muhammad Rasulullah, and we have seen such a peak in the evolution and the growth of human beings, intellectual and technological evolution, such a peak, quantum leap, are you telling me that from Muhammad Rasulullah till today the human community has not evolved? Is that what you're telling me? That we should be bound? And I will explain this in the coming lectures, why Rasulullah did what he did. Are you really telling me that we have not evolved from the time of Muhammad Rasulullah? Are you telling me that man should still take a whip and beat their women as the Quran is saying? Really? Is that what you're saying? Go and whip the women. Your intuition feels embarrassed at reading these verses and saying that this is exactly what God means. Doesn't it? When you stand in front of the United Nations today, and you talk about inalienable human rights, rights of men and women, you will feel embarrassed to say, this is what Islam says. And you know in your heart that Islam can never say this thing. And if it is in the Quran, then I have misunderstood it. For how can God say something that is so inconsistent, that is so inconsistent with the human ethos, which is so inconsistent with the vertical axis? None of you will say this. Are you telling me that Margaret Thatcher, if she saw the moon, we will have to say, bring another sister, because we don't trust you? You know who Margaret Thatcher was, don't you? She was the lady of iron, our boss. Such a brain, such a mind. If Margaret Thatcher came and bore witness, we will say, you're just a woman, you can forget. She has run our country for eternity. It seemed like eternity when she was running our country. And we will tell her, no, we want you to bring another woman to bear witness. Seriously, is this what Quran means when it says two women to one man? Really, is this what Islam is all about? That the non-Muslim is going to go to hell? So there is no use in befriending them? Those verses of the Quran, do not befriend the Jews and the Christians. Some of them are friends of each other. Do you really think they mean what you have understood in a universal sense? Today, the Christians are the ones who are showing us the way to humanity. Today, it is the country that were formerly Christians that have won some of the finest welfare system. In Muslim countries, Muslim mouths are hungry. Their children are orphaned. They are beggars. Go to those countries. You know, when I was in Makkah last year, hundreds of people died. I saluted my country. And I said, if this was Britain, we would bring them to answer. But in Saudi Arabia, you can't do this. You can't do this. But in the UK, you will get our Prime Minister to stand there and you can question him. You can hire him and fire him. Really? These are the people who are the enemies of God. And me and you are the friends of God. Is this what Quran means? These forms of Quran in which do not befriend the Jews and the Christians, we will inshallah explain that how it doesn't mean what we are understanding, it is in a particular context. But what I wanted to say was that this horizontal axis is the way in which Quran formulates the vertical axis in accordance with the need of the time. There is no sacredness about it. And if anybody wants to question tomorrow, then inshallah I'll give examples from the lives of the Imams, 5th and the 6th Imam, how they reformulated it, yes? And my time is up now, so I'll stop there if there are any questions. Can we recite Surah Fatiha for all of our marhumin? You quoted that Hazrat Ali alayhi salam sent Sahabi to lead namaz at Taraweeh. Please give the reference. Please remind me again. I'll have to ask one of my students to send it, yes? You quoted that there are about 100 sects in Islam, but according to the latest research in Iran, there are less than 73 sects. Please give the reference of any book which shows the name, number of sects. Thanks. I'm not going to ask you to raise your name, but thank you very much for these questions. Read the book Milal and Nihal, I think, from Sheristani or somebody, and you will find names of countless sects that have been historically within Islam, yes? Maybe the Iranian research is for the present day. I was talking about the historical number of sects and expressions of Islam that have been and gone. Yeah. So if you want the book again, please remind me afterwards, and I can get somebody to send us the reference. Is that all? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May Allah grant us His light to do some good in this world. May Allah allow us to surrender to Him wholesomely. May Allah allow us to care for His family, the human family of ours. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless those who have gone before us and grant them lofty ranks in paradise. May Allah hasten the reappearance of our beloved Imam and grant us the grand boon of Shahada in His divine presence. Once again, Rahamallah man qara al-Fatiha. Whoever sent this question, please see me now, yes?